We had a chance to screen the documentary about the Avett brothers, May It Last, A Portrait of the Avett Brothers. And we had a chance to check it out, so we thought we'd talk about it and share our thoughts with you. I'm Lindsay Kimball. I'm Assistant Program Director at The Current.
I'm Bill DeVille. I'm one of the hosts on The Current. Lindsay, what's your thoughts on the film?
Well, I thought the documentary had incredible access to Scott and Seth and their family and all the band members.
Lindsay,
and
did you notice that it didn't take very long for them to appear really comfortable with the idea that they were being filmed all the time? And it didn't really seem edited. It seemed natural.
No, and they were in their houses. They were, like, when Scott was, like, grabbing eggs from his chicken coop and stuff like that, it just kind of felt like, hey, we're just here. So it opens up where they're at Madison Square Garden, and there's this just funny scene where a security guard asks for their credentials. Mm-hmm. Like, are you guys supposed to be back here? And of course you're thinking, it's the Avett brothers, why are you guarding them? It's just this really funny moment and a funny way to start out. And then it rewinds back to the beginning of writing True Sadness.
It'd be like, if you're looking for truth, I'm proof, you'll find it.
And so it goes into when they first start writing that record and before they go out to LA and record with Rick Rubin. And you kind of get a sense of how they started writing the songs together. But what I really like is it gives more context, not just behind that album, but the dynamics between Scott and Seth. And how Scott's, you know, precocious and outgoing and more hyper, and how we beat up Seth just to be funny, and Seth was more of the kind of quiet, shy type, which I don't always get. You don't see that on stage because they're both performing. And then you see how that dynamic in the documentary plays out as far as how they write songs together, how they perform together, and everyone's like, I've never seen brothers get along this well before.
I've never seen, I mean, you always think of brothers, the Oasis Brothers, the Kinks, you know, all these bands that never got along, and these guys are in a band for life. And I have a feeling, you know, they'll always do their own solo stuff and dabble around, but I think the Avett brothers will always be a unit. And the way they get along is amazing. And I liked seeing them in the studio when they're working out Ain't No Man and riffing off one another, and how the songs start so organically and they work them out together.
Yeah.
They find their own parts. One will be sitting on the drums, one will be playing guitar or piano. And I also really got a kick out of seeing them in action with Rick Rubin.
Yeah.
And seeing how much he loves them is really cool, because I mean, he's the guru behind Red Hot Chili Peppers, all those great American
Slayer
recordings. Yeah, with Johnny Cash and all this other stuff, and to see him in action with the Avetts is fantastic.
Yeah, I think he does a great job of pulling their personalities out in the songs. Mm-hmm. And he's the kind of guy who just offers like subtle things that they change, and they respond to it really well. They clearly feel comfortable in there. I thought one of the lines that Seth mentioned in the documentary is about how they perform their diary every night. And I was like, that for them to feel like it's their diary, because a lot of times I feel like some of the songs are very clear what it's about, like the divorce separation blues is pretty clear.
Yeah.
He makes that point in the documentary, but there's other ones where there's a lot of different meanings you could pick up from it, but they see it as being very open and putting their hearts out there. And they're kind of private, but you understand the context of where this music's coming from and where the inspiration's coming from, and sort of how the band is kind of like another family.
Yeah.
I mean, I thought it was really cute how like Scott and Seth live like on the same road a couple houses from each other.
Well, it seems like the whole family live within. They showed that visit with their father at his farm where they're chopping wood and stuff.
Yep.
And having a little discussion and then it shows Seth and father walking through the farm and some comments that they made back and forth, and it was hugely interesting. I found that fascinating. And another part I found fascinating, just because they're this successful band doesn't mean they don't have problems too. I mean, Bob Crawford's daughter and all she went through when she was in the hospital, there was always somebody from the Avett brothers 24/7 keeping vigil on Bob's daughter.
Yeah, well, there was that quote where Joe Kwan, the cellist, was like, when Bob said to him, he's like, why are you, you don't have to be here. He's like, you do it for me, you know. You can clearly tell it's a family, but I think it's funny how they go back and talk about how they met each other and how, like, Bob barely played upright bass when they met him, and they're like, join the band, no big deal.
I forgot about that part.
Right,
that was fantastic.
Really
the first time he picked up the stand-up bass was to audition for the band.
In a parking lot.
In a parking lot.
And to hear them tell that is really funny. Yeah. And then also with Joe, they're like, come play on these couple songs. And all of a sudden he's in the band. But
he tried to figure out a way for him to stick around.
Yeah.
It's like he books the plane tickets. He books the hotels.
He was doing merch.
Yeah. And he does merch. And he also does, he's their social media guy as well. So
And cook.
And cook. So
he's
he wanted
really
to be in the band. So yeah, they keep it in the family.
And though you say there is no need, I intend to pay back when my mind was turning loose.
I think, Lindsay, that the most rewarding thing about this film is seeing the process work and how they pour their hearts and souls into their songs. And at one point, things are getting so heavy in the studio when they're recording a song. It shows them after when they're done recording, and they're sitting on the back deck of the studio in L.A., just spent and silent.
I mean, it was just the song ends, they're recording it, and it's just like they have to let it sink in because it was like they poured everything out into the song. And you kind of go, you just see Scott sitting there with his eyes shut trying to like just hold on to that moment, but also like you could tell it's just like it's the musical version of running a marathon or something.
Yeah.
They go outside and they're just, they need like moments to let that sink in. And it really shows how they pour so much into the music, and you don't really, you see that, I think you see that in a live setting really, really well. Like there are so many times where you get this kind of emotional response when they're live. They do such a great job of doing that in a live setting, and to see it in a recording session, I thought was really eye-opening to see how they put the music together and how much it's so much a gift from the heart for them.
And you know, after watching this, the film ends and literally tears of joy are rolling down my face. It felt more triumphant than anything. I thought it was fantastic.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I agree. Once again, the film is May It Last, A Portrait of the Avett Brothers. It's showing in 250 different theaters on Tuesday, September 12th. It's a one-night-only thing, and it's an incredible opportunity to see into the Avett Brothers, their songwriting, and their careers, and their dynamics. It's an awesome documentary by Judd Apatow.